Hi, and welcome back. Today we're going to talk about a new subject, which is called Investment Decision Rules. And today we're going to discuss net present value. So during this time, we're going to always have the question, is the investment profitable or is it a profitable investment? And we're going to look at net present value, internal rate of return, equivalent annual annuity, and payback as four different ways of trying to assess whether or not this investment is profitable and maybe compare different investments as well. But today, as I said, we're focusing on net present value, and the other ones will come in other videos. So basically, this is a timeline that looks like something you've seen before. But we could think of it as buying a machine, for example. So we pay 300 today, and then we expect this machine to generate an extra revenue of 50 in the first year, of 70 in the second year, of 80 in the third year, and then 100 extra in the fourth and the fifth year. And after that, we expect to have no more use of it, so there's no value after that. And the question then is it worth doing this investment? Is it worth paying 300, let's say, million, in case our cost of capital is 10%? So maybe it's not worth to receive all of these cash flows if the cost of capital is 10%. And today we're going to find out how we can do that. So just a short reminder, when it comes to financial decisions, we give up resources today, as in the 300 we just saw in the example. And we hope that it will provide something good in the future. So in our last example, we estimated how much benefits we would gain in the next coming 5 years. Okay, so let's go back to this example then. Is it worth undertaking this investment if our cost of capital is 10%? Well, as it turns out, you already know how to do this. So let's look at it. Remember that we always want to compare stuff in comparable terms, and we had a time value of money, so we need to move this, all of these investments back to today, or sorry, all of these benefits until today. And after we've done that, we can compare it, the present value of these benefits, with the cost. So the cost we have here of 300, we can compare them to each other. So we move all of these until today, and I take them one at a time because there's no, they are not all the same every year, and there doesn't seem to be a constant growth in percentage. Okay, so to compute the present value of the first one, we simply take, so we're focusing on this one, 50 now. We take 50, we divide it by 1 plus the interest rate, which is 10%, 1 plus 0.10, and we take it to the power of 1 because it's only 1 year that we need to move it. And then we're going to add the second year. So here we have an income of 70. We compute the present value of that and take it to the power of 2, because that's how many years we wish to move it. Then we take the third year, which is 80. We divide it by 1 plus 0.1 to the power of 3. The fourth year, which is 100, divided by 1 plus 0.1 to the power of 4. And the fifth year, which was also 100, then, to the power of 5, because we wish to move it 5 years. Okay, so if we enter this into the calculator, we find that it will be 256.367. So we can compare this. This is the present value of the benefits compared to the present value of the costs, which is 300. So obviously we gain less than we have to pay, and therefore this would be a fairly bad investment. And actually we could take this 256 minus 300 to find that we would actually lose 44. And this is then what you call the net present value, because we net the positive cash flows and the negative cash flows, and they are all in present value. It's a net of a present value. Okay, so in general then, what you do is you compute the present value of all positive cash flows and you sum them up like we did now. And you take the present value of all negative cash flows and you sum them up. So in our last example, we had 5 positive cash flows, which we sum, but we only had 1 negative cash flow of 300. So the net present value is the difference then between the present value of the positive ones and the present value of the negative cash flows. Or you could also say that why make a distinction between positive and negative, we could simply take the present value of all cash flows and, you know, add them together, negative or positive. It would be the same thing. And again, it's a focus then on net present value. So you always compare the positive ones to the negative ones. Okay. The decision rule here would be that if the net present value is greater than zero, then you should make an investment. So what does this mean? Well, it means that the positive cash flows, the present value of those, are larger than the present value of the negative ones. And since we can compare them when they're on the same period, it means that it's more positive than negative parts. Therefore, we should make an investment. On the other hand, if the NPV is less than zero, we don't invest because the negative side, the negative cash flows, have a larger present value than the positive cash flows. So we would lose money after we make it into comparable terms. And if we're comparing several projects and they have the same lifespan, then we choose the one with the highest net present value. So if you have two different projects, both of 5 years, and you can only choose one, take one with the highest NPV, assuming that at least one of them is positive. Okay, so now we're going to do a little bit of an interpretation. What does it mean with the NPV? So here we have an example of an investment which costs 250. So the cost is 250, and you would get 110 in 1 year, 121 in 2 years, and 133.1 in 3 years. So we could compute the net present value of this one, doing the same way as last time. We take 110 divided by 1 plus, so the interest rate is 10%, 0.1 to the power 1, plus 121 divided by 1 plus 0.1 to the power 2, plus 133.1 divided by 1 plus 0.10 to the power 3. And this, as it turns out, equals 300. And that means that the net present value of the positive cash flows is 300. And the NPV then is 300, which is the positive cash flows, minus the cost of 250. Again, this is already today, so it is in present value. So NPV equals 50. Okay, and how do I know this then? Well, we can do it like this instead. So we have the NPV equal to 50. What does that mean? Well, let's take 300 today and invest it for 1 year at the rate 1.1. This turns out to be equal to 330. Okay, then we have an outflow. We want to get 110 crowns today. So we take away 110 from this 330. Then we will still have 220 left. Okay, so let's take this 220 and invest it for another year. So this was in year one. Let's make a one here. Then we have 220 left. We invest that for another year. And then in the next year, we will have 242 crowns. Okay, and we want to remove 121 that year in year two. So we will have 242 minus 121, which is equal to 121. So this is then for year two, what we do. And in the last year, we had 121. We invested at 10% rate. And we will then have 133.1. So in the third year, we can exactly take out 133.1. So if we had 300 today, and invested it at this rate of 10%, then we could each year take out exactly the same amount as we receive from this investment. So having 300 today is the same thing as receiving 110 in year 1, 121 in year 2, and 133.1 in year 3. So it would cost us 300 to do that today. But this investment only costs 250. What does that mean then? Well, it basically means by doing this investment, we gain 50 crowns today, because without this investment, it would take us 300 to receive the same cash flows. So in that case, it's like a saving 50 crowns or getting it from nowhere. And that's exactly how we could interpret a net present value. For a firm then, if the NPV is equal to 10, it means that we increase the firm value by 10 if we do an investment. And on the other hand, if the net present value would be negative, so let's say minus 15 for example, then we would decrease the firm value by 50 if we would do the investment. So in the same way that I said that an NPV of 50 is like saving 50, a negative one would be like spending an extra unnecessary 15. Okay, so what are then the advantages of this method? Because I said we're going to talk about four different methods. Well, it accounts for the time value of money. We do that when we use the interest rate. It accounts for the risk of the project. So you have an interest rate which is related to the project. It means that that interest rate can be adjusted to the risk, and that's something good. We also account for all cash flows caused by the project. This might seem like it's obvious. Of course, we should take everything into account, but as we'll see, not all methods do this. It also provides us with information on changes in firm value. And it's easy to rank projects, at least if they have the same lifespan. And you can simply say this one has higher NPV, and therefore it is better. One disadvantage, which another method helps us with, is if we have projects with different lifespans, then they are a little bit hard to compare with NPV, especially if they can be repeated. Because then, okay, let's say that the longer project has a higher NPV, but the shorter one, we might have time to do it twice. And how do you account for that? And we will see a method to do that later. And then, of course, this is true for all projects, but are we sure that our inputs are really correct? I mean, can we know for certain that in 5 years' time we're going to receive a cash flow of 100? Well, who knows? But at least it's the best estimation that we can make, maybe, and we should base it on that. And again, with this method, we can have the interest rate higher to adjust for uncertainty in our estimations. Okay, so let's take one final example. You may invest in a project which will pay either 90,000 or 117,000 the next year. The two outcomes are equally likely and depends on the state of the economy. We need 80,000 kronor and the cost, to make this investment we need 80,000 and the cost of capital is 15%. What is then the expected NPV of doing this project? Okay, so we have all information here. We have the investment, we have the cost of capital, which is our interest rate. We have the period, which is just 1 year. And then we have two different outcomes, and only one of them can appear. So how can we do this? Well, we can compute the NPV for both cases and then take the average because they were equally likely. So let's take the bad case first. Then the NPV we would get 90,000, and the present value of that is 90,000 divided by 1 plus the interest rate 15 to the power 1, and this is then equal to 78,026. Like that. 78,261. Okay, so what is the NPV in the bad case? Well, the NPV was the positive ones, 78,261, minus the negative one of 80,000. So in this case, the NPV would actually be negative, and it would be minus 1,739, approximately. Okay, in the good outcome then, so we take that here, then we would receive 117,000. So we would get 117. We divide it by 1 plus r. 1 plus 0.15, which is r, to the power of 1, because it's only 1 year. And then, instead of doing this, like first computing the present value and then subtracting, we can subtract the initial investment of 80,000 straight away. And then this would be 21,739. So in case of a bad outcome, we get a negative NPV, but in case of a good outcome, we get a positive NPV of 21,000. So what is the expected net present value? Well, both of these outcomes were equally likely. So we can take the good one, which was 21,739, plus, and in this case minus then, the bad one, 1,739. We divide it by 2, and we get average outcome, which is 10,000 crowns. So that would be the NPV of this project. Okay, so a short summary then. We looked at the net present value today, which gives you an amount expressed as in kronor or SEK today, or dollar, whatever currency you use. You do it by calculating the present value of all future cash flows, positive and negative, and then you simply add them all together. And the investment is profitable if the net present value is greater than zero. All right, thank you very much. I'll see you in the next video.